seen the schedule and the agenda paper, there are a lot of topics and there is very little time. So I'd request everyone to keep their points as succinct as possible so that we can have maximum inputs on different topics. So like a time duration of 3 to 4 minutes for opening remarks, I think should be okay. And then of course we can have a to and fro discussion that however that goes, it goes. So I'll request Professor Mantha to, begin with the first session then,
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. This is for the higher education, right? So higher education today is a massive process. And most of the expansion has happened in the last 10 years. And to be on the side of numbers, we have about 800 universities today. About 290 odd state universities in that. And about 40 odd deemed universities. There are central universities, central institutions, meaning funded by the central government. That about 130 odd institutions. And rest of them are private institutions, private universities. So there's a big variation in amongst the universities, the kind of universities we have and so on, essentially in the public and the private sector. Some of the old institutions like TIFR and so on have become deemed universities. Some purely private universities set up in the private domain have become deemed universities and so on. We'll go into the details of that maybe a little when we get into some discussion. These 800 odd universities, the state universities, which are about 290, I said, are affiliating types. Rest of them are not affiliating universities. Though there are some central universities in the Northeast which are affiliating. That's a provision made because there are no good universities within the Northeast. So some of the central universities, they affiliate. But otherwise, generally the state universities affiliate. Now having said that, there are roughly about 42,000 institutions today which are affiliated to these institutions, these universities, 290 odd universities. And the affiliations could range from 1,000 institutions to less than 2-3 maybe, you know. So the variation is as large as that. And the students also vary. There are universities which have less than 250 students. Universities which have less than 250 students. And there are universities with maybe 20,000 students. So the whole range is too large. This is on a bird's eye view. Okay. Then there is technical education. This is the higher education space. Within the technical education, you have about 3,800 institutions today. Okay. Out of those 42,000 total number of institutions, about 3,800 are engineering institutions. And some of the institutions run multiple courses like management, engineering together. So the numbers may not be absolute in that sense. There are about 10,000 institutions which do something in the domain of technical education. Something, somebody in management, somebody in engineering, somebody both, somebody doing architecture, someone doing There are about 500 institutions in architecture, about 1,600 institutions in pharmacy. There are about 3,500, 600 polytechnics, and about 4,000 management institutions. But if you add all of them, it will exceed 10,000 because many of them run multiple programs. Physical entities are 10,000. Physical entities, right? And there are 1 million graduates in the technical space passing out every year. 1 million, okay? Which means engineering, architecture, pharmacy, everything put together, management. That number is 1 million. And the total figure of graduates in the country passing out is 5 million. There are 5 million graduates who pass out from our universities every year. Okay. And this is works out, this figure, this ratio works out favorably with any country that you talk about. Even in the US, it's about 1:5 is the ratio. So here also, it's almost the same. The difference is, whereas in the US, you have, I need to make just about 10, 15 minutes, and then ask people.
Sir, if it's even lesser, the better, because then we have lesser. Enough time for the inputs.
Okay. So I'll just give you this overall picture, and then we will. So that's about the university system. The difference that I was saying is in the US, you have large universities with many departments together and 30, 40,000 students on a university campus scene. Here, you have super specialty universities. You have a university for music. You have a university for things like that. In principle, universities were supposed to have all the departments when they started. They were focused at research, and they were not necessarily undergraduate program running institutions. That was left to the other institutions. And that is how the affiliation system started. But over a period of time, the acceptance within the society was for some courses, and some, the whole scene shifted towards exclusively towards science domain, engineering domain, and so on. So the life sciences, the social sciences, they all went down, the languages, all that. And therefore, many such departments started finding no faculty, no students. So there are departments with 4 or 5 students, 1 faculty, like that within universities. So in order to survive, some universities started off with undergraduate programs, postgraduate. Then the whole focus shifted from research. So that's the fundamental issue. So today, if our universities are not into research, there are several reasons. Some reasons are more of our own making, administrative, and so on. So this is the overall story that we have. This is the supply side. On the demand side, the industry has to employ these people. There are reports which are all, again, towards the management and technical education. There are hardly any reports which show you how many science graduates are employed, how many arts are employed, and things like that. So there, the number of people, be it the Ernst & Young report or the McKinsey report, they talk about 25% of employability and so on. There are many, many questions on those, the way those reports are created, whether it's true, not true, that we will see during the course of discussion. Because all education should lead to some meaningful employment. I mean, they make good citizens, character building, all that is fine. But you can't have a good citizen without employment. So therefore, that's the basic outcome. So we also need to map the demand side to find out how many jobs we have, what kind of jobs you have, whether there's a labor management information system at all in place. So So that's the, these are my opening remarks. Maybe you can supplement and then we will take it forward. Is that fine?
I just request everyone to like maybe focus a little bit also on the rankings bit. I mean, because that's something that on the rankings bit, because they're asking
just
about.
One second, this is the about the education. We have predominantly two accreditation systems. We hardly have any quality assurance mechanisms, though there is something in, under NAC and so on. The NAC is for the other education, other than technical. In the technical domain, you have NBA, National Board of Accreditation. The NBA does a program-based accreditation. NAC does institution-based accreditation. There's a fundamental difference. Within the, there are why and how, and there are several reasons for doing that. Each has its own plus, its own minus, its own reasons, and so on. We'll go into the reasons when we discuss. So that's the regulate, the regulation. There are regulatory bodies. There is a AICT for technical education, for general education. There is, though UGC technically is not a regulator, it's a grants giving authority. Somewhere in the path, it has become a regulator. So it's not a regulator by definition, by act, nothing. Whereas AICT was created as a regulator in 1947. An act of parliament came in 87 after good 40 years. UGC was set up as an act of parliament in 56. For architecture, there is Council of Architecture, though there is a lot of confusion between the roles of technical and whether architecture is technical, those kind of things. And there is Pharmacy Council of India, there is Dental Council of India, Nursing Bar Council, there are so many councils, each one trying to figure out what they want to do. Unfortunately, most of these regulators, they also approve and they also measure quality, which is not really correct. The conflict of interest in NAC is still under UGC. It's answerable to UGC. NBA is not answerable to UGC. They are separated today. Though there is still, technically, if you go to court, NBA also is attached to AICT. But it's much better than what NAC and UGC is. The other councils, they don't have anything. They do the approval. They also measure the quality. So that's the story. Thank you.
So I assume that we have to talk about regulation and quality assurance in higher education. That's a topic. Thanks, Professor Mantha. So my name is Kannan Modgalya. I'm at IIT Bombay. One of the things, so I'm just going to raise some issues and then maybe we'll get an answer to some of them. At least I will share what I have in mind. One of the problems I see in our academic system is that we have lot of nice things on paper, and when it comes to implementation, they are actually terrible. And in fact, this is not the story of only the academic system, but the whole country. That is why the Prime Minister said, less government, but more governance. So in fact, I would ask that, is it possible to say, what are the top five things that have to be regulated, as opposed to having some 1,000 things? You have 1,000 rules which cannot be enforced. Can we have just a few and enforce it? I see one of the things that is our regulating agencies have been unable to do. For example, people should have so much of facility, and then so many faculty members, and people so that people and not more than so much of fees. In every one of them, there is violation. We know that they say something as fees, but charge something else. We have not been able to enforce that, right? People say that we have so many faculty members, at the time of inspection, they're all there, but they are actually not there, okay? So I would, in fact, ask this question, is it possible to have, you know, a few rules, only a few rules, and if so, what should that be? So that we can enforce them, we can guarantee that those are followed. If there is a rule that cannot be enforced, why have it as a rule? For example, one of the things that I would say is, there has been so much effort to limit the fees, tuition, okay? But not at all followed, not at all followed. Everybody knows that unless you pay X amount of money, you will not get admission, and it does not appear. Isn't it better to say, charge anything you want, but not a single rupee as black? Whatever you charge, officially state. No, get rid of whatever it is, charge anything, doesn't matter, because, I mean, it is foolish to say that education is, you know, not expensive. Given that the government institutions, government supports only a small number, and there is a large number of institutions that have to be supported outside the government system, and education is expensive, unless you get good money, good salary, you don't get good people. Charge whatever, what it will do is, it will allow good people to come into the system. On the other hand, because the rules affect the good people, you have all the regulations. That's why I'm saying we should not have a rule that cannot be enforced. If you are able to enforce the rules of fees, tuition, and things like that, it is totally broken. Given that it is totally broken, if we don't have a guarantee that it will be enforced, remove that rule. That's all I'm saying. Yeah, contractual. In fact, I have a comment on the contractual thing also. It is better, I would say, pay a lot more money and bring more people as contract. Pay three times the salary. Pay higher salary, charge enough money. Anyway, these are some of the points.
I think, sir, in the contractual, among the contractual teachers also, there is a high degree of discrepancy among them themselves. No, some are getting paid sixth pay, some are getting not getting paid according to the sixth pay levels and all. And therefore, there is among them, a lot of exploitation is going on. So when we talk about regulation, if you look at overall India also and see at different universities and how they are being treated, there is disparity in that also. There is no uniform policy towards contractual people, and they are the ones who are suffering the most.
So let me finish. Yeah, no, I will just, I'm talking about just the regulation.
Yeah, we'll just take 3-4 minutes for each person. Make some opening remarks, then we'll do all that, the discussion part. Because there is a, this subject is a concurrent issue, partly on some mistakes, and some other issues you raised may not be addressed there.
The other point that I want to raise is the agencies such as like NAC, NBA, and so on, are they really independent? So that is another question I would like to ask. Is it possible to make them completely independent? Is it possible to have, for example, if you look at industry, you have something like CRISIL and so on, which do a, you know, rating, and we believe that. Now, can we have the same thing? Is it possible? Is it desirable? You know, that is something that I would like to raise. The other thing is about, because this is, we are also talking about quality assurance in higher education. We are talking about quality. I believe that we also need a mechanism that ensures that we have, so one is to create a mechanism by which quality comes automatically. The other one is to say that I will not worry about how the environment is set up, but I am more interested in assurance. So that is the thing. So I would ask this question. In fact, my biggest complaint is when we talk about higher education, especially technical education, which I am familiar with, one of the major problems that I see we have is we have a system in which our children are forced to prepare for competitive exams from the age of about 10 or so, and then we say that 99% of them are not good enough, and then they are second class citizens because our elimination process takes only 1% at high level, whether it is architecture, whether it is design, whether it is engineering, all of it. So I think one of the things, if we really want to have quality assurance, we need to have a mechanism that will ensure that some quality is actually possible. That why should somebody at the age of 10 have to decide they want to do design, they want to do engineering? Should we not push it to a higher level? Is it not possible for us to provide some decent education at the first degree level? Because now everybody goes for second degree. First degree is more or less required for almost everybody. So that is another point that I would like to raise. Thank you.
So it does not really have scientific temper as, you know, as a deeper outcome. It does not say, the word scientific temper appears very sparingly in the whole document. Then there is actually an absence of social outcome of education. What is the, other than student outcomes, what are social outcomes which are intended? So one of the most important social outcomes, of course, development. You know, the informal sector, the big sector, which needs formalization. So it has to happen through new knowledge and new delivery mechanisms. It is completely silent on that. And another very important silence is on the role of the university. Is the university merely to produce students, you know, who are employable, or does the university have any other regional role as a regional role model, or as an access to people for having their questions solved or some, you know, relevant research done? So it is again silent on what exactly is the role of the university. Then I think it also suffers from a national approach. You see, as Professor Mantha said, that it is a, you know, it's on the concurrent list. So it would have been better for this to really see what is the difference between the state and the nation. The central government cannot run a few centrally funded institutions on big budget and forget about all the others who must run, you know, all these, 95% of students must go to state-funded institutions. So I think the CBSification of this national agenda or national education is a big, is a big step, and we should really, see it very carefully. So I suggest for this meeting, which is in Bombay and which has a lot of regional college people, that we see the state versus the national agenda, and that we as state people, how are we to, you know, run various programs at the state level with a lot of our students whose parents are coming from the informal sector, whose aspirational problems are there, and so on. And after all, employability does not mean employment. You know, there is a lot more, formalization which needs to be done. So I think all of these are very major issues which seem to be, which do not seem to be addressed here at all. It seems like a very much a bureaucratic, and it is two members of the three are actually bureaucrats. So there is, what can we say? Then, if you look at AICT, the same, what runs in Himachal Pradesh, what is engineering in Himachal Pradesh is engineering in Maharashtra. So that seems to be a great misfortune, in the engineering game. I mean, when the Prime Minister himself has said in front of the President to all the IIT directors that science may be global, which also I doubt, and that, but engineering is local. So it seems to be a complete, so I think that also we see that abet, or we see the, we see in terms of regulation, we are, if you look at what exactly is the curriculum on which we are basing our accreditation, it is typically abet, American, whatever, and so on. So we still have no body of knowledge. Civil engineering in India, what does civil engineering mean? There should be a body of knowledge that a student should know all of these things. Right? And if you see that there is no body of knowledge, so all these accreditations are very short on homework, and they are basically relying on, you know, ABET or some such rigor, foreign rigor. So, for example, if you look at the civil engineering body of rigor, the word sewage does not appear in it. And we have a Swachh Bharat mission. So I think, you know, we have to really do the hard work if you want to run accreditation. You know, we have to generate the homework to do it. So I think ranking, again, is overstepping the center's ambit. Centers, if you look at the constitution, the ambit is to control quality. You see, controlling quality is regulation, which says that you are good enough or not. To say you are better than someone else, A is better than B, is not the center's job. You know, is A passable or not is the center's job. Is A better than B is not. So in fact, I think the JEE, NEET, all these exams are actually challengeable in court. If you really make a case, it is very difficult for the center to justify how can it rank people or institutions. It is not in their brief. So I think that all of these issues should be, I think that the centralization of a country which is 1.2 billion strong is unnecessary, and we should really review this whole process. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Kalpana Kannan. I'm from IIT, and I manage the massive open online courses of IIT Bombay. So I would like to give my input on the quality assurance in terms of teacher training and regarding that. So in IIT Bombay, of course, we have been conducting large-scale teacher training program to improve the quality of engineering education in the country. And what I found was like around 30% of the teachers who are teaching in engineering colleges, they are just B-Techs. So B-Techs teaching B-Tech students. So that is, in fact, I have gathered information over a period of, you know, more than 5 years. And around 70% are M-Techs, and less than 10% are PhDs. So this is the situation in most of the engineering colleges in our country. So very few PhDs, and so unless we improve the quality of teachers in the country, I'm sure the engineering, I'm only talking about the engineering education, I'm sure it is same for other disciplines as well. So unless we improve the quality of teachers in the colleges, we cannot improve the quality of education in the country. So that is one thing which I want to stress. And another thing, I find the students are quite smart these days, and we need teachers who can, you know, handle such smart students. And we have to train them in multiple, you know, how to use ICT, how to, you know, make better use of the information which is available in the online. So all this is required in present day. So teachers have to change the way they have been teaching all these years. So they have to definitely change, and which is very important. And one more thing which I want to stress is the creativity of a person. Like a child is very creative, but because of our education system, we have, you know, made them so most of the children are just doing rote learning, and which kills their creativity. And creativity is very important at every stage, be it research, be it innovation, or anything. So creativity, encouraging people to, you know, be creative is very important, and that is which, this is one point which I would like to stress, that this has to start from the school level, and this is not happening. Like, very few students are encouraged in a creative manner. That's it.
Thank you, Professor Kannan. I am Dr. Archana Mishra. I'm from Jai Hind College. I have certain views on this higher education and the quality and regulation. As Professor Kannan just now mentioned about the teachers' training and the quality of teachers, I have one very realistic perspective to be brought in, and that is, as we teach in multi-faculty colleges, and we are dealing with programs of mass media, we're dealing with arts, we're dealing with travel and tourism management, for instance, international relations and all this, we find that the teachers today are overburdened with the workload. There is a bureaucracy outside, there is a bureaucracy inside, and the result is that we have a workload of 20 lectures per week, which means about, you know, you're teaching on average 3 to 4 hours every day, and looking at the whatever the UGC says, minimum 5 hours to be clocked in the college, and then you have the other notional hours to be spent in the research time and all. So the time for the research is very limited. And here, the teacher's quality gets affected. Number two is that what I feel is that when we talk about qualifications, I agree with Professor Kannan here that majority of the colleges do not have 100% doctorates. They do not yet have been encouraging such people to even shoulder the HODs, so responsibility. So even the HODs, who I personally believe would be setting an example before the whole department, if they have also not been able to complete the doctorate over there, I mean, it sends a wrong signal that we do not give a priority to teachers' qualification going up, as well as augmenting by means of research. Second thing is that we talk about technology, but the implementation of technology has not happened adequately. And as a result, what is happening is a lot of time goes in manual labor, in handling about administrative activities, and even teachers, the number of hours required to teach a particular curriculum, minus technology, is actually consuming a lot of time. And so we actually need to see 100% switch over to technology-based teaching. I think zero tolerance for non-technology-oriented approach, even for arts faculty, because even there, we need in the arts faculty to incorporate a lot of data-based study as well, and which is very much important. The third factor I feel is that the learning curve of the students has been coming down. So the outcome, what is the final outcome? The quality of students whom we are creating. And I feel somewhere here, as the document says very correctly, there is an erosion of values among the students. So we do see a lot of students with a lot of attitude around, and we'll see that they have sort of not picked up the right values, and they end up being, a lot of responsible citizenry is not seen among them. Also, the fact of employability. So then again, what you see here is that the employability is not 100%. As Professor Kannan also pointed out, a lot of creative children are missing out in the whole process. And therefore, they just tend to follow the herd. And therefore, offbeat examples are very few who are able to really come out with outstanding results or come out with something really new. Then another factor which I feel which we face in everyday process is that the regulation of time, timely examinations, and to declare the results on time, also have the teaching hours completed and the curriculum being met, the requirements, the value addition to the curriculum, which can be a lot more better if time management is better. So I think regulation of the hours, the teaching hours, the value addition hours, and the workshop hours or whatever. And like, for instance, in the summers, we could have a lot of foreign programs coming in, which could fill in and the summer internships and all for the students here, which is off late, I think, not been noticed much in many colleges. And the last of all, which I feel, to maintain a good quality of the teachers and the students, is a very high motivational level of the teachers, as well as the students. And for the teachers, it's been increasingly seen that I think their HR issues are often an issue. And it's never addressed by the college or the university and everything, whether it's their pending areas and all, or any other issue. These issues are not being met in the way it should be met promptly. And so there is a bureaucracy, as I mentioned, inside, and there's a bureaucracy outside, and which takes away the complete motivation of the teachers. Also, the research which people are coming out with, there should be a strict regulation of the quality. If we want the quantity to go up, it has to go up qualitatively as well. So these are my views.
If I could just add very quickly, if you could have some very specific targeted inputs towards NAC or NBA in terms of like all the guests, after the initial comments, so very specific inputs regarding the accreditation agency, should they be revamped? If revamped, how? Yeah.
Sujata here, Sujata Natarajan from Wellington Institute of Management. There were a lot of aspects which were raised earlier, meet faculty, fees, books, infrastructure, ranking, teacher training. Now, if you look at even the international models, you see a lot of accreditation agency like ASESB and other Equis model. There are a lot of emphasis on mission-driven approach and the involvement of different stakeholders, including the vision community, leadership, and the academic fraternity in making the policy. While you're looking right now to comment on AICTE, NBA, lot of times we also realize there are times you need regulations to regulate quality, to have maintain that quality. But you need to maybe differentiate and look at institutions in different categories, because you have public universities, private, and also self-finance institutions. So can we look at a part of identifying different category of institutions and categorizing them and giving them autonomy? So there's a lot of flexibility right now being taken by the regulatory bodies to give autonomous status to institutions, allowing private players. So one part is the competition actually helps you to just make it market-driven phase. Let's see what happens. And so there is more transparency if it's possible. So market leads what is required, because you know, you do realize a lot of funds is required for higher education to flourish. So at one point of time, everything is regulated. That is one element which I was wanting to re-emphasize in terms of the fees. In terms of faculty, we always keep hearing there is a paucity of talent, and international agencies do say there is an AQ, academic qualified and professionally qualified. And there is a move towards that direction. So we need to re-emphasize that how far we can bring practitioners who are in the industry, considering there is a paucity of talent, and we want the relevance to come into the curriculum. We want people to be more employable. Can we look at more industry, professional, or participation in the curriculum? That is important, not only in the delivery, but from the designing till the end phase. So you'll tackle the part of employability is what we were saying. So regulatory, you have some mandatory qualifications met in terms of regulatory requirement of who can be a faculty. So that part was a recommendation. Maybe we can relook at it and make it more broad-based from the faculty point of view.
Ma'am, you mentioned autonomy. So in autonomy, what kind of yardsticks would you want the regulatory bodies to have to grant autonomy? Like, are they other ones? Yeah, I mean, like, to be very...
So you're looking at new courses. So if you're looking at the future is looking at analytics, and you're talking about IoT is coming in. So there is a lot of flexibility required. So there was sometimes the process for applying and getting approvals. So there could be a flexibility of launching courses and also closing down courses to that extent. So we know there are sometimes when there are obsolete courses still being run institution. But can we relook at it and the somewhere the institutions can be enabled to expedite the process of launching and maybe closing down courses for that matter, if you're looking at. So we're looking at even technology for that matter. We're looking at everything, a lot of resources being online. And a lot of transparency has been created through the AIC portal being put completely coming online. So there is a transparency there. But if you're looking at the e-learning material that is available and the stipulation of how many books that you need to keep adding, now there is somewhere we need to look at, are we looking at the quantity of books, how much you add as a sign of how the institution is performing? Or are we looking also to somewhere keep in mind the e-learning resources or e-books that is coming into place also? So to meet some quality or an aspect to launch a new program, you're unnecessarily also buying books. So when you're talking about the technology or e-learning platforms, we may need to look at the physical resources also is one of the recommendations.
I'm Dr. Rekha Bahadur, and I'm Vice Principal of HR College, just retired now. I'll just rapidly run through, because I think we are running short of time, and some points are repetitive, maybe. First thing I believe is that the government should not be a regulatory body, but rather should be a body which plays a proactive role in improving quality of education. Government can look at fees, government can look at reservation, government can look at funding, because I think funding is a big issue in this country and government cannot back out of funding. So that's something that I was very keen on. And while they are talking about a 6% GDP that they would be giving for in the NEP, I think at least a 10%, so that when we come down to ground reality, it comes down to 5 to 6%, right? At present, if they're just giving you a 3.5%, which is not sufficient for 1.2 billion population, with 50% of the people below 25. The other point that I wanted to say is that one can have an autonomous statutory council of higher education in each state. So because each state has a very different, geographically they are so different. So when related to the demands of that particular state, like Professor Sani rightly mentioned, so council can have one representative of the government, but others should be academicians. We need industry people, and we also need representation from students in these regulatory bodies, because they are the people who are, these are the stakeholders. So what I suggest is that we should make education autonomous in teaching and learning. But there could be regulations. We can't stay away from regulation, because then there would be complete misuse of whatever is available. UGC, according to me, needs to be dismantled. I'm being a little strong. And because there are many archaic laws and they need to be changed. Over a period of time, like Sir rightly said, it's just a regulatory body. And we cannot have government representatives deciding everything. I think there is a need for academicians to play a bigger role. So what we can, as the government has suggested, I think that's a good idea, to replace it by an education commission. That is a good idea, but it needs to have a think tank of high quality academicians, industry people, as well as, you know, people who are stakeholders in the sense, and owners of various educational institutions. All of them need to be represented so that the ground reality of the country can be, you know, thrashed out, not just bureaucratic controls. Today we've become teaching universities. You know, we have nothing, but we are just teaching, and I won't repeat the point that you said, but very rightly said. Coming to quality assurance, this was related to regulations. And I just want to mention, see how the UGC brought out the IIM bill on autonomy. So, you know, these are things that I think we need to look into. In terms of quality assurance, the first thing is we need to fill up the vacancies of teachers. We talk about quality. There are 40% vacancies exist only in central universities. Second point I would like to say is that we need to build proper infrastructure for quality. Right, infrastructure is needed, and a must that we should have is faculty development programs. Without faculty development, there can be no quality. Today, we are all mediocre, you know, teaching universities. So for quality, faculty development is a must. Bureaucratic controls to be reduced. Political appointments of chairpersons of, you know, NAC and NEPA and vice chancellors, all these are political appointments. I think this needs to change. Curriculum needs to drastically change if we want quality. And what we need to bring in is more practical training, like internships, where student and industry need to be a part of this. Without industry, I don't know what we are talking about. And student are our final customers, so we need to know what they need. Please reduce textbook-driven exams. That is something which we have resulted in just creating standardizations, you know. No innovation, there's just standardization. And like Sir rightly said, only 25% of the graduates today are employable. This is all because we have these kind of textbook thing, and everybody's preparing for entrance exams, so they're just not basically concentrating on anything else. Last point. And compulsory social service component should be introduced. One to two month internship and a compulsory social service import should be introduced in order to bring our better quality. Thank you.
My name is Amit Dasgupta, and I'm actually involved in the next session. But I couldn't help but react and say that I'm, by the way, a former bureaucrat. I used to be in the Indian Foreign Service, and I plead guilty for that. So my association with education has been fairly limited. I used to head the Mumbai campus of the SP Jain School of Global Management, which has campuses in Dubai, Singapore, and Sydney. And I started the Mumbai campus, so I was the first head. And now I am the India director for the University of New South Wales, which has campuses in Sydney and in Canberra. I think my immediate reaction would be, when I read through this document, is that I don't understand it. And I don't understand it for one reason, which is the same reason as to why I didn't understand earlier education policies. Nowhere in this document does it say why you need an education policy. In other words, what do you expect that education policy to achieve? And unless you define what you want it to achieve, you cannot define the strategy. The entire document is based on what it wants to do without clarifying why it wants to do it. Now, I'll just take the basic point of regulation and quality assurance on this, and perhaps expand on it when we get to the next session. You see, it's all right to have a regulatory authority if you know what the regulatory authority is going to do. And you can know what it's going to do only when you've defined the end objective of education. This is not there. And as a consequence, as Milind was saying, it tends to become more and more and increasingly bureaucratic. And anything which is bureaucratic becomes a stumbling block for growth. It becomes a cesspool of, pardon the use of the word, not only bureaucracy, but associated evils with bureaucracy. You do need to take assistance in order to hasten and fast track. The question is, when you put in a quality assurance, your end objective of the kind of student you want needs to be defined well beforehand. Let's face it, we know today that all of you who are in the world of academia, the student is going to, that whom you are investing so much time with, is going to do a job that has not yet been created. That's the end objective. When you and I were children, I mean, my case, some 70 years ago, I didn't know you could make money designing apps. Did any of you think you could make money designing apps at the time when you were kids? So what is happening today is that when you put in a regulatory body and a system of quality assurance, it is completely devoid from the end objectives of what education ultimately needs to achieve. To my mind, therefore, I would have actually recast the entire document. And it's all very well to have a preamble which tells us what Gandhiji wanted and Vivekananda wanted, etc. What does the government want to do? How does it perceive the future? Where is India going to go? And therefore, what does India need? And how can education then contribute to India's future requirements? That is absent. Unless you insert this, all the discussions tend to become very theoretical. It tends to become something in the air. It's all right for us to say, and I know all of us would agree, the pedagogy has to change. But change for what? Technology has to be embraced to do something. But embraced for what? What is the end objective? This is clearly lacking over here. And that would be my basic point. I'll elaborate on this when we pick up the next session, of which I'm a part.
Prior to that, I was an assistant professor with Mumbai University Engineering. So my perspective is as a teacher, as the very low rung where I face things. So for me, I have concentrated on the NBAs. Like, I've been part of three NBA meetings, and what I have seen is if the aim is to have that quality assurance, then it is lacking. First, the NBA members. The selection of members is not known. It is not transparent. The evaluation. I mean, how do you evaluate one department, other department, one college, other? That is not transparent. And unfortunately, I have been part of a system where we have bribed the NBA members. So it is a very sad story, and there is no quality associated with it. And clearly, the people I work for, they said we are an engineering factory. We are least bothered if TCS employs 100 of my students, Infosys employs hundreds of my students, I am least bothered about quality. So from that perspective, for me, even if this is in this document is applied, but how much it will trickle down and how much it will actually take place, that is, according to me, a big thinking is required on that point.
Can I make a comment? Yeah, I was actually going to ask for a very short closing remarks if I did want to make, because we'll begin the next session in the next 5 minutes itself. Yeah, you can make your closing remarks.
I just wanted to actually reinforce your point and say that we actually need an independent agency which has to clearly come out with the benchmarkers. What are the benchmarkers against which we are evaluating? And then this has to be a very realistic exercise too, because what is achievable in the context of what can be achieved is the first step to prioritize. And then we see phase-wise that this is what is to be achieved. And then accordingly, we should have the policy. So I think we need to break down this broader policy into small nitty-gritties to achieve phase 1, phase 2, phase 3. And that's how it could be, I think, more implementable. That's what I feel.
Yeah. So what...
Yeah, that I said that this is a broad policy document. For instance, it says an independent mechanism for administering the national higher education. A, independent, what do you define by it? And who is going to appoint it? And then whether it will be co-functional with UGC or not.
Now, this is, I believe this is a policy document. The detailing and all will happen, later.
Yeah.
But I tend to agree with many of the things that Das Gupta ji said. I mean, to be fair to the process, when I joined, this is my personal experience that comes in, and understand how the process goes on. When I joined AICT, I thought regulation is necessary. You do this, you do that. But there were several unfair practices at that time. Every regulatory process has inbuilt mechanism for corruption. this is something that I learned the hard way. Going from the days of within 2 months that I joined the CBI, all over the place. So, without getting into all that, the point is, by the time that I left, I was leaving AICT, I thought, why at all a regulator is required? These are some of the issues which are there. Fundamentally, we need to understand whether a regulator is first of all required, and if it is required, what are the functional aspects of that from the perspective of what you want the system to do. I know every system, everything that you talk about has a regulator. And ideally speaking, in education, I would see that there's no regulator. But then, like you said, there will be so much of exploitation, and there are disadvantaged groups and so on, and people who have... Probably this whole concept comes from that socialistic pattern that the country started off with, maybe. But I don't know. But I believe if there is a regulation, regulators, like any process, the outcomes must be very clearly defined. This is where you come, this is where you get off. And today, between the regulators' roles, between the professions, there are so many regulators, between the professions, there's so much of overlapping, and this invariably gets into turf war. And nobody does anything when it is difficult. And everybody claims when it is something that, helps them. So therefore, this document, I also believe that a lot of change fundamentally has to happen. Whether this group has some mandate, I really do not know. But some document will have to be created from this end, which articulates everybody's views and puts it in a form which is our input to this effort. Having said that, there are several points that people are talking about which essentially comes in the university domain. The national policy, how it can change that, I really do not know. For example, the teacher load and the time and the value-added courses, and these are all essentially in the domain of the vice chancellor. If he thinks today any institution can do any value added course, which vice chancellor would stop him from doing that or penalize him from doing that? The point is, if there is finances involved and if there is government involved, then there is an issue. Otherwise, I don't think there is anything stopping anybody in that sense, period. Having said that, this gives rise to one more issue. We are all talking, fundamentally, our institutions, people talk about autonomy as a model, and autonomy, they do, everything will be, as though that is the end all for every problem that we have. Please understand, we have 40,000 institutions which are affiliated today. Where do you begin and where do you end is one issue. Second is, within autonomy, there is managerial autonomy, there is financial autonomy, there are academic autonomy, there is administrative autonomy, all kinds of things. We want government money, but we don't want government control. That is the principle which goes on everywhere. So, So therefore, the system should be built in, I mean, the regulatory provisions must be there in such a way that you're free to do everything, then don't come in, and so on. And it's...
autonomy as well. And yeah, do you think the colleges really are ready for financial autonomy?
No,
that's another thing.
No. We are not getting into specific details will lead to a lot of thing. But these are all just points that we are flagging off. The real difficulty is if there is autonomy, people do not want to exercise it. I mean, I know there are institutions which are autonomous today, but every small thing they go to the state government for permissions. Why does that happen? Then why do you need autonomy? So these are specific issues which come into different domains. We need to, first of all, say regulation is required. Like somebody said, it should be facilitating. What amount of facilitation is something that we have to define, how it can really become facilitating, and so on. Yes, today we also need to understand that only 20 people out of 100 eligible candidates go to college in higher education. And therefore, this entire system, are we talking for those 20 people? So therefore, we have to evolve a system that looks at the entire, we have a 20 GER at this time. And in the secondary education, the GER is just about 64. And below that, it's 9. So 98 becomes 64, becomes 20. And there are so many people who are dropping out from the system. So does the policy, the national policy, it has to fairly take into consideration all those people who are left out of this system, so-called university, institution, college, all that. Build in a robust skill education system that builds skills and also provides opportunities, lateral movement, vertical movement, all that. Those things must be built in into the policies. As far as regulatory processes are concerned, obviously you need a local system, regulatory system that helps our institutions to grow. And there, the policies must lay emphasis on employment and employability, like people said. Employment is the absolute numbers that we have. And employability is the skills that you have. Before doing that, somebody has to map the demand side. How many jobs you have, what kind of jobs you have, what kind of, tomorrow, your entire skill program, the National Skill Qualification Program, it becomes redundant, it becomes another education system where you have so many plumbers but no jobs, so many electricians, no jobs. So those kind of things should be built into this. This is a fairly involved subject. I don't think it can be done in 45 minutes or whatever. And when you have 8-10 people, people have articulated their comments. What we can do is ask them if it is possible to give.
We plan to collate that into
whatever
a
whatever you
document.
Think is workup that you want to see in the education policy, maybe submit it to them. We can put all that together and create a supplement to this.
So we'll anyway be compiling a document based on today's discussion. So in addition, the emails are of course like very helpful if that happens after the event.
Yes, given the signal 3-4 times now, so we end this. Thank you.